Thought I'd try something a little different. Want to go outside. It's a beautiful day. This is a lecture on the Renaissance period intended for my Music 110 class, Introduction to Music. And I'm doing this to sort of accompany the PowerPoint slide program that I've attached to Blackboard for my students. So students that are watching this, open up the PowerPoint and you can follow along on the PowerPoint with what I'm talking about. We're going to talk about, like I said, the Renaissance period. We talked about the Middle Ages, roughly from the 4th century right up through the 13th century. The Renaissance officially begins around the 14th century through the 16th century. Some scholars will say that it goes back into the 13th century, and that when we studied the Ars Nova, as you just looked at in the Middle Ages, a lot of people say that's really the beginning of the Renaissance, and it could very well be. There's a lot of things happened in the Ars Nova that are come to fruition in the Renaissance. Now, with this video, I'm gonna post two videos, actually. I'm posting this lecture for you, but I'm also going to post another lecture, which I found it online, and I thought it does a good job of sort of summing things up. So it's interesting to look at. And what I'm going to try to do is go into a little more in-depth detail. Now, as I told you, we finished the elements of music. We're looking at the historical periods. I feel very strongly about studying the historical periods because I think it is in our study of history that we learn more about what happened so that we can look to the future and prevent the mistakes. Now, to get on the soapbox, I don't think that's happening enough because too many people are downplaying the importance of history. And because of that, we make the same mistakes. Think about wars. This world has always been in a state of war, and everybody talks about wanting peace, so why can't they have it? Well, they didn't learn from the mistakes of the previous ages about what causes war, the aspects of greed and the desire for other people's stuff, the wanting to lord over people and gain power. All those may be problems that will never be solved. But I think teaching history leads us to a better version of what can be. The problem today is revisionist history. People wanting the world to be the way they want it, so they go back in history and change things. And we're seeing that a lot. And the sad thing is, without teaching history in depth, that makes revisionist history so much easier for the people who want to tell you that things didn't happen the way they did. Now, that's one of the reasons I wanted to do this. Because, like I said, there's some good lectures on YouTube that you can find. There's a lot of information about the Renaissance, and it covers things usually in 4 to 5 minutes, but not in detail. I'm going to try to cover some things in detail. So I've opened my PowerPoint. I'm on the very first slide of the Renaissance, where it says the progression of music through the Middle Ages to the Renaissance. This is just sort of a synopsis of where we've been and where we are in the past 1,000-year period, roughly 1400 back to 400. You could divide the Middle Ages up into several sections, and I wish they had in a way. But listen to this and look at this on your PowerPoint. We started off with a single line monophonic and monosyllabic chant, very basic sound. Then came melismatic chant, which was development, and it began to define the melody of music. Next, we added a drone for simple accompaniment and harmony. Then came polyphony with several voices. Leon and Periton were the ones who gave us polyphony. Guillaume de Machaut wrote the Mass, and in it he used polyphonic sound. Then we had secular music with instruments coming in back from the Crusades. Most of the Crusaders came back, and with them they became troubadours and trouvères, jongleurs were with them, basically gypsies. And we see the rise of secular music. And finally, you have the Mass that I mentioned. There in the Ars Nova is when all this began to really gel as more and more people were doing this. Now, we come to the Renaissance. If you look at the slide that says the Renaissance, 1450 to 1600, you'll see characteristics. This slide is what I'm going to sort of break out and talk about. So go to the slide 3, and you see the characteristics of the Renaissance. First word you hit is the word Renaissance itself. That's a French word, but oddly enough, as a French word, it's describing what was going on mostly in Italy. That was the center of the Renaissance. The word means rebirth, but the question that came up, and a lot of people never ask, is if you're going to rebirth something, what are you birthing again? Obviously, it was not the Middle Ages, because everything you see is a reaction to the Middle Ages as society changes. They're wanting to open things up. They're wanting to get away from the heavy hand of the church and the prohibitions of the church so people can live their lives. So what are they rebirthing? And the answer to that is they skip over the past 1,000 years and go back and look, and there they find the Roman Empire. Well, the Roman Empire, from the church's standpoint, was synonymous with persecution. And I just like to imagine that these people started looking around. They see all these things that Rome has done, but with it, there's another layer of older buildings, some of the most beautiful buildings, things like the Parthenon and some of the buildings that were built even in Italy. And they ask, well, who did this? It's the Greeks. And so they think, well, let's go back and look at these Greeks. Now, here's where I think a little revisionist history comes in, because I think even the people who were looking at the Renaissance began to see what they wanted. They looked back at the Greek society and they said, as far as art and culture, these guys had it going on. We need to be more like the Greeks. They saw the art, they heard the music, they brought it back to the Greeks. They realized that the Greek language was what was being spoken during the Roman Empire. Latin was not the spoken language, it was Greek. Latin later will take charge when the church takes charge. So the question is, what did they revise? They basically looked at the Greeks and checked them all off as everything Greek is good. Well, they didn't look real hard, because with every civilization where there's beauty, there's also brutality. They sort of looked over that. Now, we do the same thing here in the modern age. And I will get on a little bit of a soapbox here, because I think it's important for you to understand this. One of my pet peeves has always been the word democracy. We constantly talk about the Greeks giving us democracy, and we talk about how America is a democracy. Unfortunately, it's not. And I don't really mean that unfortunately, because I'm sort of glad we're not a democracy, because when you study democracy, you begin to realize that a lot of what we have created in our mind is a political myth. I watch the news a lot, and I see people say, we've got to save our democracy. Well, we're not a democracy. If you want to know what we are, just say the Pledge of Allegiance. People don't even think about that. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the democracy or republic for which it stands. It says it right there. That's sad, too, because when I was teaching high school, I found a lot of students refused to say the pledge. They said, well, I don't like this country. I thought, well, leave. But you can't say that. It's politically incorrect. But they don't even realize we're not a democracy, we're a republic. So the question should be asked, why are we not a democracy if it was so great? And the answer is, democracy wasn't so great, and it really isn't. But to say that, people look at you and say, oh, you're evil. But think about democracy. What do you know about democracy? Oh, the Greeks gave us democracy. Well, actually, it wasn't all the Greeks. Democracy is pretty much something that rose up in Athens, and it didn't last very long. I mean, on the scale of history. The first 100 years was an experiment. The second 100 years was disaster. The Athenians tried democracy. I'm trying to think, it might have been Aristides, might have been the guy's name that started it. But he had this idea that everybody should be equal. And so he came up with the idea of voting, and democracy was about voting, where everybody would drop a pebble in, a white pebble for yes, a black pebble for no, and everybody got to vote. And I thought, this is great, except for one thing. In a true democracy, it's not democratic, it's mob rule. Say you have 100 people. Well, if 51 of them choose to, say, commit murder and rob, then the other 49 are forced to go along with that. the mob controls everybody. We say, well, it should be majority rule. Really? If it were majority rule, then slavery in the South would still be here. What stopped it was violence, where the Northern armies, which we could say were the mob, came down and defeated the Southern armies because they didn't want them doing that. Now, I'm not saying slavery is good. I'm just saying, look at the perspective of what it was. It led to violence. Mob rule and democracy are a problem. That's why we're not. So people say, well, why did the Founding Fathers reject democracy and make us a republic? Because a republic is representative. People are represented. We see this again today with, like I said, people are running around saying, we've got to save our democracy. And what do they want to do? They want to be a democratic state. Well, some call us a democratic republic simply because we do have the vote. But a lot of people don't realize that the Electoral College decides the elections. And they get upset and they say, well, we need to do away with the Electoral College. Well, if you do away with the Electoral College, then you're back to mob rule. You're also disenfranchising the majority of the country. So in other words, if the Electoral College is done away with, you have about four, maybe five states that will determine every election. That means you have 45 states that will have no voice in it. The small mob in those states will rule the whole country. Our Founding Fathers knew that. They looked at the Greeks. They admired their architecture and their art, but they said their way of government failed. And by the way, democracy failed in Athens. It led to violence. Eventually, in the last few years of democracy, they made it to where only certain people could vote because they felt like the lower class people were skewing the vote. So democracy suddenly began to look a lot like Jim Crow laws, which, by the way, there is a parallel. You take people you don't like and you say, well, you don't get to vote. We have a democracy, but only certain people get to vote in our democracy. And democracy in Athens failed. And why was it never tried again? Well, maybe because they knew it failed. Let's look at the Renaissance. If the Renaissance was so Greek-minded, why didn't they adopt democracy? Because they knew it didn't work. They chose their system. Now, they were moving out of the feudal system, but they still had their lords and their nobles to control. They still had peasants, and they still had what was a middle class, a feudal class, where the priests were working for the peasants and for the nobles. But now we had a new group of people coming into the middle, and that was the wage earners, the workers, not the farmers, but industry. And that's what made the Renaissance so unique. They did not try democracy. They still wanted the lords to be over them for protection. They held the army. They still wanted the church to have power. They just wanted to take away some of the power from the church and give it to the nobles. And they wanted to make it safer for peasants. But also they wanted business. And that's one of the watchwords of the Renaissance. It was the Gilded Age where guilds, which were workmen, began to have more rights and power. This is why our history today doesn't take the time to teach that to our students. We say, oh, America's a democracy. Well, that's not true. We're a republic, and we're a republic for a reason. Now, I won't bore you anymore with that little political rant. But I'm just trying to tell you that the Renaissance was an incredible time period, but we have to be cautious that we don't create our own version of the Renaissance. The social reaction of the Middle Ages is what it says here on this slide. Era of creativity and exploration and change. Those are very important because the society was reacting to the Dark Ages, to the Middle Ages, to the Medieval Age, where the church basically kept everything static. Everything was a status quo. There was no advancement. And so for 1,000 years, an entire millennia, the European world basically survived. We're fighting off assaults. We got involved in crusades. But none of that really furthered society. In the Renaissance, we open our minds up for creativity and imagination. That's important. You have exploration and change. This is the era of people like Columbus, Da Gama. We'll talk about those in a minute. And it was influenced by Greek, but it wasn't influenced by Greek government. It was Greek architecture and art. Here's a house on this next slide. This is slide 4. And those who don't have this PowerPoint, I apologize, but you're probably not in the class. But it shows a typical house of the Mediterranean area. And what it is actually a typical house built in the style of the Greeks. flat roofs, two-story, stables down below, living quarters above, and inside courtyards that are open and windy, or I should say breezy. It's very logical, very symmetrical. It serves as a mini fort, but it also is very comfortable. This was what the Greeks did. Now, look at slide 5 in your presentation. This is called the Age of Exploration. Here again, we say that and we move on, but this is extremely important to understand the Renaissance. And with that, you're thinking, wait, this is music class. Everything we're talking about will be reflected in the music and the arts. Here I show you some people. I mentioned Marco Polo first. Even though he was not a Renaissance, he was on the tail end, or he was at the beginning of the Ars Nova. But Polo did something in that by traveling to China, opening up trade route, he sort of ushered in this idea of newness coming from the newness that we have. I wasn't planning on having a visitor in my video, but I guess we'll have to put up with that. So anyway, Marco Polo, from the pre-Renaissance period, he's coming about and he's giving us travel, trade, that opening things up. Then you see Christopher Columbus. We all know about Columbus and what he did. Bartholomew Diaz, Vasco da Gama, Ferdinand Magellan. What you need to understand there is all of these guys were explorers who opened up sea routes. Diaz tried to sail around Africa. He failed, but he came back and he opened a navigator school. And most of the navigators of the day were trained by Bartholomew Diaz in Portugal. Then you have da Gama and Ferdinand Magellan. Da Gama did make it all the way to India. Then you have Ferdinand Magellan, who is considered the first man to circumnavigate the globe. That's sort of half true and half wrong. He did go around the globe, but the last part of it, he was dead. He died in the Philippines. But he gets credit, and they brought his body back, and they buried him. These guys create a new attitude of the world, because the world up to now was the Mediterranean world. They knew about these other places, but nobody went to them. Polo opened the door to the east. Columbus opened the door to the west. Da Gama, Magellan, these guys showed us that the world is a big place. There's more going on. With this newness, the exploration of the world changes all the cultures. All of the cultures now begin to adapt to new cultures. We see that happening. It happened before. When the Crusades went to the Middle East, they brought back some of that culture. Now they're going all the way to India, all the way to China, and they're bringing back aspects of that culture. The other important thing is on slide 6, and it talks about Renaissance thought. Now, here's another confusing thing where we try to revise history. We often teach that the Renaissance was all about getting rid of the church. That's not true. The Renaissance was all about elevating humanity. And why? To achieve what they believe was God's goal for man. The church was still in power. The church was still integral and a very important part of their lives. But they began to look at themselves and say, we are made in the image of God. What are we doing to look like God? Humanism at this time, and by the way, there is modern secular humanism today, which is very different. The humanism of the Renaissance was a philosophy. And to put it simple, as I try to do on the slide here, is basically elevating humanity and focusing on what man could do. But he always thinks in terms of God has given him these things, these talents, these abilities. There was a greater concern for everyone instead of just self. At a time when people were thinking about, I got to get to heaven. Now they're thinking about, we've got to work as a group because the world is a big place. And we had sent missionaries into the barbarian regions of Europe and it had been Christianized. Now we had a whole new world to send missionaries. Humanism showed this concern for people. It tried to help people. It was a good age. This spread throughout Europe. It borrowed from some of the Greek and Roman ideas, so that's where we get that Greek thing. It was trying to develop people to be the whole person fulfilling potential. From that, we get the word the Renaissance man. Perhaps you've heard that. What is a Renaissance man? Well, it's someone who is trained in all sorts of fields. They were artists, they were politicians, they were religious, they were warriors, and they could do it all. That's the Renaissance man. Now, from there, we go to slide 7. I mentioned one of the great innovations of this period, which, again, will open up the doors of learning, and that is the Gutenberg Press. Around 1440 to 1450, you have Gutenberg. He creates a printing press. Now we have mass printing. Remember in the Middle Ages, if you read a book, it had to be written by hand. And the main books were written by priests. They were the Bible and some religious commentary. Now you could write any kind of a book. Also, for our musicians, you could print your music so that someone else could see it and play it just as you wrote it. The Gutenberg is a massive creation. This was for the Renaissance. This was their version of the laptop computer and the internet all rolled into one. Little side note about this, interesting. Gutenberg sold his press to a Frenchman. Gutenberg was making the Bible, printing Bibles and stuff, and he was giving them away, basically. The French guy started selling it, and then Gutenberg had to go back and recreate his own press so that he could make money off of it. He started creating things. But this is the opening of the mind and things. Now, on slide 8, we talk about the arts, and here's something that may seem silly in a way, and I was going to demonstrate it until that car pulled in right behind me. But it talks about the trends in art. The biggest trend in art was done by Filippo Brunelleschi. He gets credit for it. And basically, he looks at something and he realized there's something here that's not being caught. And that is the reason that, well, say behind me, over here, those trees are only that tall. That tree's that tall. Yet we know the tree is actually much taller. So what is that? Well, it's perspective. Things at a distance look smaller. But when they used to paint, they painted everything flat. That's why you'd have a castle, and the king standing beside it would be as big as the castle. I think I actually show that on slide 10, if you want to look ahead. But what Brunelleschi did was he began to see things with perspective, and he began to try to draw instead of flat surface. He now developed the idea of dimensionality, three dimensions. I show you on slide 9 some of the things, and it's credited that this one thing here at the top left corner of your slide is the baptistry in Florence. And it's supposedly this is where Brunelleschi got his idea, because he saw this building and he realized that it's an eight-sided building, and yet the front looks taller than the sides until he goes around to the other side, and then the sides look taller than the front. And he realized that what he was seeing was three-dimensional perspective, and he began to capture that. He saw that in the cathedral in Florence, in the dome. That's another picture of the baptistry on your slide. But he began to think, well, we need to capture this. This is that slide I was telling you about, slide 10. On the left of that slide, you see a typical Middle Ages painting where everybody and animals and everything is the same size. But on the right, you begin to see Brunelleschi's idea of the vanishing horizon line, where a tree up closest seems taller than a tree off in the distance. Now, this may not seem like a big deal to you, but remember, this is a revolutionary concept in visualizing art, because now it was closer to reality. The church actually didn't like it, because it's almost like man was now trying to become God by creating things. Our next slide, slide 11, shows Botticelli's Birth of Venus. It also shows a lot of new trends, because in the Birth of Venus, you have Venus coming up out of the sea on a half shell, and she's not got any clothes on. That was a bit shocking. She has this long, beautiful red hair covering most of her private areas, but the whole fact that this was painted would be shocking. The church had forbidden all nudity and things like this. But here, they're not looking at this from a sexual standpoint, but from a beautiful standpoint, and they quote Scripture. They said, well, we were created by God naked. Yeah, so God saw us and created us this way. In this painting, and I'll just touch on it briefly because I know a lot of you may not be able to see it, but you see the image of what a perfect woman is. And off to the left, you see an angel carrying a girl, and you see the image of what a perfect man is. And it's typical broad-shouldered, muscular for the men. The women, though, everything is demure. Her shoulders are sloping and weak. She's sort of heavy around the middle and large thighs. That's a symbol, by the way. When a woman has large thighs and a heavy waist, then they think she bears sons. So her children would be sons, and that was desired. That's where all these customs come up, and they reveal a lot about the culture and the way they were thinking. Moving along, we're going to talk about a couple of guys here, and I'm doing this rather quickly because a lot of this you already know, but here's Michelangelo. Michelangelo is best known for painting the Sistine Chapel, and there's a couple of scenes of it. The thing about Michelangelo, though, was he didn't consider himself a painter. He was a sculptor, and yet he's known for this. Now, in the Sistine Chapel, there's several things, and I'm going to jump over to slide 14, to one of the most, I guess you say, challenging portraits at the Sistine Chapel. It's the centerpiece. It's God imparting life to man. And people look at that and they think, oh, well, hell, God's reaching down, touching man. But there's some things in this that Michelangelo painted, which are sort of like hidden messages. And that's another typical thing of the Renaissance. There were a lot of hidden messages. In this one, man, the first thing is, you notice man, he's lying there reposed. He looks lazy. He has to prop his own leg up on his knee. His wrist is bent. God is reaching to him, but man can barely reach to God. Yet God is coming in force and power and strength and touching man, giving him life. But the thing that most people find curious in this painting is God is surrounded by small cherubim angels, which, by the way, I won't get into it, but cherubim are not little angels. But the other thing is, like, what is God in? It's this big purple circular thing with, looks like legs and stuff hanging down from it. And people struggle for years thinking, what is that? Is God traveling, you know, in a pomegranate or something? And there is an anecdotal story. I think it's true, but I don't know for sure. But supposedly there was a doctor on tour, and when he looked up at that, the guide said, "We don't know what God is in." And the doctor spoke up and said, "I do. He's in a brain." And this guy was a brain surgeon. And he said, and he began to point at things. He said, "That is a cross section of the human brain." And when you begin to compare it, as I do on the next slide, you realize that it sort of looks like the human brain. So what was Michelangelo saying? Well, probably he was saying the humanistic theory that God had given us a brain. God is the source of all knowledge. God is the great cosmic brain. So why shouldn't we use our brain to a fuller extent? You'll see that in a couple of drawings. There's another painting, I put a little bit of it in the same Sistine Chapel, where it shows a man upside down, and yet his neck has these bumps, and people thought, well, what is that? Well, the same scientist says, that's another view of the brain. Michelangelo put the brain in the Sistine Chapel for a purpose. And you can look at these slides and see what I'm talking about. Now, moving on, Michelangelo, there's a slide 17, talks about how Michelangelo saw himself as a sculptor, not a painter. We see some of his greatest sculptors, the David, I think that's the Pietà of Madonna and Child. He was probably one of the greatest sculptors that ever lived. But moving away from him to another guy, like I said, I'm trying to move sort of quick. We'll talk about Leonardo da Vinci. Da Vinci, famous for painting the Mona Lisa and the Last Supper, was someone else who didn't see himself just as a painter. He actually saw himself as an inventor. And what did he invent? Well, he invented a lot of things, but you may be surprised to know that particularly when he was in Florence, he was inventing weapons. And he was best known for inventing some of his weapons experiments. We see on slide 19 an example of the rifle, which is precursor to a machine gun. It has three rows of rifles, and they fire and rotate multiple times. He also envisioned a tank, which is in the upper right-hand corner, which was oxen inside a protective shell with cannon on the inside, small cannon, that could rotate and move on the battlefield, firing as it went. The other two slides are interesting because Da Vinci envisioned aerodynamics. Up in the left-hand corner was his version of what we call a helicopter. And people laughed at it until the Air Force Academy built one and attached a motor to it and saw that it actually did achieve lift. Very rugged, not that great, but it did work. The other is his famous glider. His mistake was he tried to make the wings flappable because he had studied bird wings and found that that didn't work. But he came back and created stationary wings that would glide, and that did work. So he envisioned air travel and to be used as a weapon. He also envisioned a parachute. I don't have a picture of it, but he created a crane with a parachute so that you could attach it to the castle, and if the enemy invades the castle, you put this on the back and the royal family could jump out of the castle and the parachute would lower them safely to the ground. The guy was way ahead of his time. Now, on slide 20, we come to a man named René Descartes, and he's in the late Renaissance, but what he does is extremely important to the understanding of Renaissance thought, and he almost takes us out of the Renaissance and takes us into a new secular age. René Descartes is famous for saying, cogito ergo sum, which translates from the Latin, I think, therefore I am. This was the question of existence and reality. This is where this came from. He began to think, well, how do we know anything is real? How do we know, you know, that art isn't more real than reality? And so he posed the question. His answer was, I'm thinking about it. So that proves that someone is here thinking. I think, therefore I am. This will be a paradigm shift in logic and philosophy, and also in the nature of reality. It will lead to people like Isaac Newton and his three laws of thermodynamics as he thinks about the reality. Slide 21, I want you to look at and notice this guy. This is Martin Luther, and this is an important aspect of the Renaissance because it deals with the Protestant Reformation. And in simply put, the Protestant Reformation is what brought an end to the Renaissance. It was a war between Catholic Church and groups of the North that protested what the Catholic Church was doing. Martin Luther was a simple priest, but he questioned some of the things that the Pope was doing. Pope was raising money. He was selling absolutions of sin. And what that meant was if you had sinned, you could go to the church, make a donation. Based upon your sin, the priest could say, well, you should pay this much and do certain acts of contrition. And you could be forgiven and saved. Well, the idea of salvation came in. And so Luther protested, and he sent a letter to the Pope and said, this is not in keeping. You know, read the book of Galatians. It talks about the free gifts of salvation. Read Ephesians. It talks about salvation as a gift. It's not something you can buy. Well, the Pope said, well, come on down here and we'll talk about it. Luther thought, no, because others who have questioned the Pope haven't come home. And so what happened was he refused. Long story short, Pope sent people to arrest him. The local German dukes liked this because they didn't like to see the church getting all the local money. They had done it through tithes and taxes, and now they're doing it for selling of absolutions. So they said, no, this is our priest. We'll keep him. And there was, just long story short again, a war. And it was a brutal war because some of the places, particularly in Austria and Germany, you'd have one village that was Catholic and the other that was protesting, and they'd raid each other and kill each other. Eventually, when the Islamic Empire invaded and the Ottoman Turks invaded Europe, they made it all the way to Vienna before the Protestants and Catholics realized that, hey, we're fighting each other and killing each other. And they're going to come and kill both of us because they have swept across Eastern Europe up from the Middle East. And so they had a truce. A Polish prince came in and defeated the Turks outside Vienna. They withdrew, and the truce held. It's always been a touchy truce, though. But you had the protesters calling themselves Protestants, and the Catholics now will call themselves Roman Catholics. And it's been that way ever since. But what that did was it stopped the Renaissance in some ways. Oddly enough, and maybe proudly enough from a musical standpoint, the artists still managed to try to work together. There was a well-known school in the Netherlands, what is today the Netherlands, called the Flemish School. They exchanged ideas. Some of the composers exchanged ideas with the Italians. So there were still some bridges being built, but the theological world was thrown into turmoil, and this ended the Renaissance. Now, on slide 22, I do talk a little bit about Renaissance music because there's something else going on. We talk about Catholics and Protestants. Some of the Renaissance, I guess you say, musical characteristics I mentioned here, you'll see them on the pop, that the music of the church was no longer as popular because people wanted to hear more secular music, and it was done with more instruments, more vocal styles, and it was just popular. One thing they did was called word or text painting, where they would write a lyric, and then they would try to represent that lyric in the music. good example, and I'll play the piece for you, is called As Vesta Was Descending. If you listen to that, it's talking about people running around playing, and it talks about how Vesta had descended from Olympus. And it says, as Vesta was descending, and the notes go down. And it talks about someone else going up, and they were ascending, and the notes go up. There's a section in there where it says that we were singing two by two, and you have multiple people singing, and three by three, more people, and then solo, all alone. Everything in the text is demonstrated or represented in the music. This was sort of a fun thing, and people liked to listen to music, so they could listen and find those little keys. The other thing was a cappella music. Most music was a cappella still. Instruments were being used, but the church still liked a cappella. Now, there's a misnomer here. A cappella, if I ask you what it means, most people say without instruments. That's really not true. What it means is for the chapel, because the music was written for a chapel. And in the chapel, there was no instruments. So that's where people get the idea that a cappella means without instruments, when really it means this is music written specifically for the chapel. So, other things. I show you some composers on 23. I just wanted to familiarize with some of these names, because we'll see a few later. Gibbons, Pierluigi, Palestrina, Delassus, Monteverdi, but we'll talk about them. The next slide is slide 24, and this is very important because these were the two most popular, most prevalent forms of vocal music. One is called the motet, one is called the madrigal. I squeezed the mass in there because the mass is still going on and it uses some of the motets. But it was a form, but it was a grand form for the church. A motet, as you can read here, it was sacred music. It was talked about the Virgin Mary and praising her, and talked about Jesus and all that. And some of that was used in masses, but usually it stood alone as what we today would call like a choir anthem. Now, if you look at a madrigal, I say it's similar to the motet, but it's secular. I shouldn't have said similar, because stylistically, form-wise, it is exactly like a motet. They're the same. You could change the words, and a motet becomes a madrigal, a madrigal becomes a motet. The difference, the madrigal was, a lot of times they were fun songs to sing. So what we have there is two vocal styles that are primary within the period, that reflect the culture and what's going on in the period, their entertainment and their worship. So the two have come together. I mentioned two men here. One is Palestrina, the other is Thomas Weeks. It looks like Welch, but it's Weeks. These were your primary composers. Interestingly enough, let me show you these guys on the next slide, 25. Josquin des Prez was a master of the motet, whereas Thomas Weeks was a master of the madrigal. Des Prez was European, Weeks was an Englishman, and so you have the two. Oddly enough, Weeks shows up on a cathedral stained glass picture, but he wrote mostly madrigals. But this just shows you the reverence they had of these two guys. Now, I know this is a little bit long, but I've ran through it very fast, but when you come to slide 26, I want you to look at that slide, because essentially you're looking at your test. I'm going to give you a test and post it with this lesson, but it's talking about terminology. There's 16 names and terms I want you to be familiar with. And then I'm going to ask you, there's four questions. The questions can be long answer, but really you can answer them pretty quickly. For instance, what effect did the Protestant Reformation have on the Renaissance period? Simply put, the answer would be it ended it, stopped it. Compare and contrast a madrigal and motet. Aeschylus did that. Madrigal is secular, motet is sacred, but they're the same music. Did the printing press help or hurt music? Well, the answer is it helped, but it also hurt a little bit because there were no copyright laws. But basically, it helped get more music out to more people. And as more people got the music, more people learned to read. So it helped education and music. And then define the idea of the Renaissance man. We talked about that earlier. A guy who was what we call today jack of all trades, or master of all things. But that's your test. Now, on the tail end of this, there is, pardon me, I shouldn't have said it that way. At the end of this part, there is a whole section of Renaissance instruments. You can look through those. I encourage you to go to YouTube, look at these instruments, and listen to them. If you hear that sound, that's sounding on my phone, so disregard it. But we're pretty much through with that. I'm going to stop there because, like I say, this lecture's gone a little longer than I'd planned. But I did want to hit a few of these topics. Watch both videos. It doesn't matter what order. The first one is about 5 minutes long. You'll probably enjoy it because it's sort of funny and entertaining, but it hits the highlights of just what I've been talking about. And I've tried to go into a little more in-depth explanation of some of the things going on. So this will be posted. This will be lesson seven in the Renaissance. I'll post this on Blackboard pretty soon. But I hope you've enjoyed it, and I hope you enjoyed this lesson. The Renaissance is an incredible period, not only for the arts and music, but just for the spreading of all this throughout civilization of the world. But thank you again. I'll see you later.